Welcome to Antoine's Kitchen. Well, I guess you guys don't care. You're here for telescope stuff. So tonight, we're going to go to the backyard and we're going to image a bubble in space. So the Bubble Nebula. We imaged this target, I think, 2 or 3 years ago, and it turned out pretty bad. I mean, back then it was okay, but I don't like how it looks now. So I'm actually leaving in 2 days on vacation, and I've been imaging the Bubble Nebula for the past 3 nights. So tonight is the last night. This was my last night imaging, before going away for a while to see my family in France. So I was really hoping that everything went according to plan. It's going to total about 18 hours total of exposure. So I've been using the SVX-130 with the GM-1000 10 micron, new mount, amazing. And QHY-600, so we're doing SHO. All I'm missing is more HA. So we will image HA all night. Okay, so this is what the Bubble Nebula is going to look like with our telescope. Let's find it on Astrophotography here. And around 10 p.m. is going to be, let's see how high, around 36 degrees. Usually I wait until 25 degrees before I start imaging a target, but from home, 36 degrees I think is just enough to pass the neighbor's rooftops. So I'm going to check now something very important that I really want to try this time is to include not only M52 in there, a cluster, but also a second nebula which is called the Lobster Claw Nebula. So my framing here with just the SVX-130 and the full frame camera is like that. So plenty of space for the bubble, but sadly we cannot see the lobster claw, which is sad. But anyway, luckily on SGP we can see much more gas than on Scatafari. So I'm going to make sure that on SGP I frame both the Bubble Nebula and the Lobster Claw Nebula, and then once I launch the images outside in the backyard, I'm going to double check that the framing is perfect as well as the angle, because both the angle and the framing have to be perfect for both nebulae to fit, because they're huge. One thing that concerns me is that I have some random spikes in RA, as you can see here, like a completely random. Like this spike is like towards -4, which is really, really stressful, because this can ruin the image. So I'm hoping those random spikes stop. Another random spike, and yeah, really this is not something that you want to see. I will image this all night and will wake up at 4 or 5 a.m. before the sunrise so that we can pack up the mount before it gets too hot. So I bought a UV light because my friend Avo just moved very close by to my house, and he has a bunch of scorpions inside and outside of his house. So I'm actually kind of worried and wondering if my backyard is also filled with a bunch of scorpions, because if so, then my cat Gilbert would kind of die. So with this, I'm going to see if any scorpions outside glow. Let's go. And there was no scorpions, just some bright flower petals. The night was perfect. No clouds, not a speck of wind, no crazy cats. Perfect. I woke up before sunrise to grab the data from the nook and pack everything away before it got too hot. So here are the files that I've just processed, so I can show you guys how many I have of each. So we have HA, S2 and O3. Of course, this looks like a ton of files, but you actually have to divide this by 2, because
the drizzle files are included as well. O3 and S2 have 36 files, whereas HA has 69 files. So hopefully it's a good choice because there is so much HA in there. Processing this wide view on the bubble and Lobster Claw Nebula was a ton of fun. I knew this would be my last time processing an object for a very long time, so I took my time and enjoyed it a lot. And here is the final result. Alright, so I'm really happy with how the image turned out. You can see the colorful bubble nebula in there with a bunch of gas all around the image itself. You can also spot the Messier open cluster in the frame, as well as the obvious, the Lobster Claw Nebula, which is huge and amazing looking even by itself. So I am overall really happy. And before we say clear skies, until next time, we got this book recently, which is The Backyard Astronomer's Guide, the fourth edition by Terence Dickinson and Alan Dyer. And we like to mention books that we use to learn in this hobby. So on the Galactic course, for example, we have a video as well as a list of all the books we read to get better and better in astrophotography. And this one is our newest one, which is honestly probably number one by now, because it has everything you can think of to learn this hobby. I was trying my hardest to find something that was missing in there, but I couldn't. So there is literally everything from binoculars to processing to stacking to cameras, and literally everything is in there. So if you guys need a book to learn this hobby or just get better, I would recommend this one, which is very new. You can even tell because Neowise is on the cover here, so you know it's recent and just came out this year. So check it out, I'll have a link below. And yeah, I am really in love with this one here, and it's super thick. Alright, so we'll see you guys next time. The next video will be about finding Charles Messier's grave in Paris. So, we'll see you guys next time, and clear skies.